Hello, hello, Mordimer here, and welcome to another exciting tournament online. This time it's Speed Chess Championship. We already had the four tournaments. In the, I think, last half year, we have a couple of tournaments. Speed Chess Invitational, Speed Chess Super Swiss, Speed Chess Grand Prix, and Junior Speed Chess as well. So four tournaments, and the winners of these tournaments or runners-up also qualified to the main event of Speed Chess Championship. Now let's see the Speed Chess Championship. Here we go. As you see, we have Hikaru Nakamura and Magnus Carlsen as the two main seeds. Also Wesley So and Maxim Vachier-Lagrave respectively as number four and number three. And they were invited to that tournament as the best blitz players in the world, because according to the FIDE ranking list of the blitz chess players, they are top players in the world. Also, as you see, we have other players. Eight of them were invited and eight of them had to qualify. So I show you already one of the game where Jan Krzysztof Duda won the Speed Chess Invitational and he was qualified to this tournament. And Nihal Sarin won the Junior Speed Championship. And in the first round, he's gonna play against Maxim Vachier-Lagrave. Now, about this tournament, we have only one pair per day, and it's not an every day. Sometimes we have break, like 1 day, sometimes 2 days, 3 days, or even 4 days. So all these tournaments gonna end, I think, at the beginning of the December. But for now, I would like to show you one of the game between Nihal Sarin and Maxim Vachier-Lagrave. For your information, the players play the match. First 90 minutes, they play the blitzes, 5 minutes for the player, plus 1 second incrementation, then another 60 minutes in the tempo of 3 minutes per player and 1 second incrementation, and finally 30 minutes of 1 minute per game per player and 1 second incrementation bullets. So all together 180 minutes, 3 hours of chess. And I just choose one of the most interesting games between Maxim Vachier-Lagrave and Nihal Sarin. So without further ado, let's see what happened on the board. We have knight f3 by Maxim Vachier-Lagrave, so Zuckertort opening, and now d5. So this way we have a ready with knight f3, d5, this is the ready opening. And now another transposition, we have g3, king's Indian attack by Maxim Vachier-Lagrave. We have g6, symmetrical answer, so double fianchetto variation. And now we have bishop g2, bishop g7, and d4, pretty much symmetrical. Knight f6, we have castle, and now c4 is the main idea here, transposing actually to the Neo-Grünfeld defense, the classical variation. However, we have knight b to d2 with the idea of bringing the bishop, developing the bishop on this way, maybe on this or on this diagonal. We have c6, so Nihal Sarin plays very solid chess. And now again c4 is possible, c3 symmetrical variation, why not b3, making a space for the bishop. This move were played pretty often. However, we have a4 with the idea of playing e5 and already squeezing a bit the queen side. So we have a5 blocking that move, and Nihal Sarin doesn't like this. And now we have b3 making a space for the bishop. Knight a6 with the idea of bringing the knight to b4, bringing the bishop also to f5, and also that can be a very unpleasant target on c2. So this is why we have bishop a3 now, taking under control b4, and also pinning the pawn on e7. We have rook e8 unpinning, and now c3 saying, okay, maybe you want to jump with the knight, but I don't want to give my pair of bishops. So c3 gonna actually controls b4, the knight cannot go there, so your knight is stuck over there. You have to find a better way to develop this knight. We have bishop f5 as planned, and now we have the one game in the database played actually 30 years ago where knight e5 was played. However, here Maxim Vachier-Lagrave goes for rook e1. Rook e1 with the idea of e4. e4 cannot be played yet because, of course, the e4 is controlled 3 times. However, if the knight is moved, then why not? The bishop and the knight gonna support together with the rook. So that is the idea. Nihal Sarin immediately jumped to e4, so blocking any possible e4 moves and also attacking the pawn on c3. We have rook c1 defending that pawn, and now knight d2 eliminating one of the supporters of the e4 move. And now knight d2 isn't that great because black also would like to strike in the center. Look at this. This bishop also, you know, control e5, and now black would be first in the center, and white would have to pick up this pawn or maybe defend by e3 or even maybe that would be the craziest move. This would be the really crazy move in the center. That would be very, very sharp. However, black stands slightly better here, so this is why we have queen d2. e5, this is not what Maxim Vachier-Lagrave want to see now, but now we have bishop e4. So again, e4 is not possible. And also, if the knight is moved, then black actually can exchange light square bishop. So Maxim Vachier-Lagrave want to avoid that. We have bishop h3, and now queen b6, another great move by Nihal Sarin, beautiful played. Now he found another way to develop with tempo. Queen b3 is a threat, and also look at this bishop, very nice controlling b1 and c2 square. So queen d1 defending this way. And now finally this bishop did what it's supposed to do, and now we have bishop f3, e takes on f3, and now it's black which actually goes with the e5 move. So we have e5, d takes on e5, and now a couple of exchanges. And now queen c2 taking under control c3 and also preparing for e1. So both of the players would like to take the control over the e-file. This is the only open e-file in the game. And of course rook e8 isn't that great because after rook e1 black would have to play something like queen d8 first and only then move the bishop, and so that's the losing tempo. So first bishop f6, and now we have rook e1. So seems like Maxim Vachier-Lagrave took control over the e-file, but Nihal Sarin didn't say the last word. Now this knight, which was very passive on the 8-6, found the way out. So knight c5 attacking already b3. So rook goes back to b1, and now this is Nihal Sarin who took control over the open e-file. We have bishop f1. And now king g7, king g2, and now knight e6, remaneuvering the knight. We have bishop c1 with the idea of harassing the queen and taking over this diagonal, but Nihal Sarin play another great move, queen c5, already attacking the pawn on c3 twice, so bishop just go to d2, and now we have d4. Very interesting, this pawn is already attacked twice, and of course the pawn cannot be taken because the queen is hanging, so this is why we have c4, and this way Nihal Sarin actually created the passed pawn, and he could, for example, go for some move like queen on b6 or maybe queen to a7 and support that pawn. So that would be very dangerous, protected passed pawn. However, we have b6, so first defending this pawn, and the queen is going go somewhere else. So Nihal Sarin has a different idea here, but now we have rook e1. So Maxim Vachier-Lagrave is going to fight for the e-file again. But Nihal Sarin said, okay, you can take the e-file, I'm going go for the d-file, because now I'm gonna push that pawn. So we have h4 and saying Maxim Vachier-Lagrave saying, okay, show me what you're gonna do. We have d3, and now actually it's quite some calculation here, and remember this is the blitz game, so both of the players definitely are in the time troubles, have to play very fast. Bishop d3 was possible, and after, let's say, queen d6 attacking both of the bishops, this is probably what Maxim Vachier-Lagrave didn't want to calculate. There is the simple solution, rook d1. And this bishop cannot be taken, So black would have to find another way. If the bishop is taken, then of course black gonna lose the queen and the game. Okay, king h6, rook d3, and so on. So this is why we have queen c1. So Maxim Vachier-Lagrave found another target, h6 square. And this is the critical position of the game. Nihal Sarin, by playing d3, he makes a space for the minor pieces. So a very attacking idea. He sacrificed this pawn and Maxim Vachier-Lagrave didn't take it. But now which piece should land on d4? Usually knight is jumping to the squares like that, and in this case Nihal Sarin played a knight d4 with the attack on the on this pawn, so it's obvious idea. However, bishop d4 in this case was much stronger, and the idea is that this pawn cannot really be defended on f2. Okay, so that's the idea. Bishop e3 doesn't really work, because after bishop e3, f takes on e3, black has something like d2. It's not winning the rook, however it's still not really comfortable to play. Rook d1, and now let's say queen e5, forcing to exchange the queen. If the queen is moved somewhere, then this pawn gonna be lost, and yeah, white actually forced to play, and black stands pretty good here. The knight can jump now to, for example, c5, attack this pawn. This pawn is very, very annoying. It's gonna take a couple of moves to eliminate that pawn, and black gonna have a lot of time. So black stands better here. So after bishop d4, bishop e3 was not possible. Rather bishop d3 with the same idea. Of course, bishop f2 with the attack on the bishop was possible, but simply rook d1, and this bishop cannot be taken because it's guarded by the tactic. Okay, so probably bishop d4, and the position is pretty much equal. The pawn structures are pretty much symmetrical, and the game can be played, but probably after bishop d4, Maxim Vachier-Lagrave would go for the bishop h6 first, and after king g8, then queen d2, defending f2. That makes a lot of sense, and for this time the queen is defender, not the greatest defender, but black doesn't have a really great plan here. Probably queen b4, maybe exchanging the queens, and continue this way. Bishop d3, this time it can be taken, but of course black can also choose to win the pawn back, and after king f2, rook d3, then rook e3, and the position is completely equal, and it could be played. So bishop d4 was the best move in the position, but the position of course would still be equal, but very active game for black. However, we have knight d4, and it looks like much stronger move, but it's not really the stronger. Of course, the pawn on b3 is attacked, and it's not easy actually to defend that pawn, because this bishop also control a lot of squares around, so white have to be careful what they are doing. The problem is after bishop d3 and knight b3, which looks like extremely strong move, attacking the queen, attacking this bishop, also this bishop is under attack. What would you play as white? Bishop h6, this is what played Maxim Vachier-Lagrave, king g8, and now this bishop is still under attack, but Maxim Vachier-Lagrave doesn't care. Queen f4, and saying, okay, you want to take my bishop? It's not really possible, because you're gonna get checkmated. So that's the problem. Bishop on h6 is extremely strong now. Probably bishop g7 should be played, but it's still losing. Look at this. Queen c7 attacking the rook. The rook, of course, have to be defended. The bishop still cannot be taken. So queen f8. And then bishop g7, king g7, rook e7, and white have a very strong position, very active position. And this bishop cannot really be taken, because now queen e5, and the king is in the troubles. If the king goes to the a rank, then white gonna win the queen. If queen h6, then we're gonna have queen f6. And again, there are a lot of mating ideas here. Actually, black cannot defend. The rook f7 is coming, and then queen g5, this is a checkmate. Let's say knight d4, rook f7 with the attack on the queen, and already we have a threat on g5, and it can be defended. However, now we're gonna have another checkmate on h7. So this way or another, that would be the checkmate. Probably knight c5 would be the best, but it's still, even eliminating the bishop doesn't really work. The bishop gonna take on the c6. Black can avoid that, but still, this endgame is much better for white. The rook gonna go back to e7. There is a lot of pressure on the f7, and also the queen actually can eliminate these two pawns, and this pawn gonna win the game. At the same time, look at this shelter. This king is the king in the shelter, unpenetrable. If black want to actually have some counterplay, would have to bring the rook and the queen to the game. But of course, if that happened, then white would deliver a checkmate on the dark squares. These dark squares are really, really weak. So position of the black would be hopeless. Nihal Sarin try something else. Queen d4, defending the bishop and also asking to exchange the queens, but the problem is doesn't work. Rook e4 blocking, at the same time attacking the queen. The queen of course cannot take the bishop because we would have the checkmate on g7. This is why queen c3 by Nihal Sarin, and now queen e3. Look at this. Maxim Vachier-Lagrave actually threatening another checkmate, this time on e8. So we have rook f8, bishop f8, king f8, and now queen h6. We have bishop g7, and now queen f4, threatening yet another checkmate, this time on b8. So the bishop goes back, making a space for the king, and now h5 by Maxim Vachier-Lagrave. So h6 is coming, and now the king is not going to go to g7, because that's gonna be the checkmate on b8. So this is why we have g takes on h5, but this actually allow Maxim Vachier-Lagrave to finish in style. Again, queen h6 with check, we have bishop g7, but now the pawn is not on g6 anymore, so the queen can go to d6 and attack this side. And in this position, Nihal Sarin resigned. And he resigned because it's a checkmate in the couple of next moves. So king g8, and now rook e8, bishop f8, and that of course would be the checkmate. So after queen d6, he just resigned. Very interesting game. Remember, that was the blitz game. Very sharp. Both of the players had seconds on the clock, and I would like to just show you the final score, the standings after the first day. As you see, Maxim Vachier-Lagrave got 16.5 points, Nihal Sarin 11.5 points. So this is Maxim Vachier-Lagrave, number 3 in the blitz ranking in the world, who is advanced to the quarterfinals, and we're gonna see another game. So definitely I'm gonna show you more games from this exciting tournament. And if you like this video, press like. If for some reason you don't like it, press unlike. And if you don't want to miss other games from that tournament, press subscribe, smash the bell button. Thanks for watching, and see you in the next one.